Hi, everybody. My name is Lenore Von Stein, and this is another episode of The Facts. This is a discussion episode, the second of two discussions with David K. Johnston, and because I didn't do the T before. And so we're talking about the economy, taxes. We're talking about it, creating inequity, how inequity has the different these different threads that can be pulled together and create economic injustice, what I'm calling economic injustice. And you were, before we went on the air, David, you were reading some headlines of current headlines, and we could just toss them around. Have you got some of those to toss? Or
I've closed those down. But I mean, fundamentally, on the point you're raising, you know, here's what we've done under Reaganism since 1981. We have created a society where all the gains are going to a very narrow group of people at the top. And let me give you a couple of killer numbers here. In 2012, the average income of the bottom 90% of taxpayers was a little over $30,000. That's less than $600 a week. It's 20% smaller than it was in the year 2000. 20% smaller than the year 2000 when you adjust for inflation. But here's the shocking thing. It fell back to the level of 1966 when Lyndon Johnson was president. Most cars didn't have air conditioning, and we were fighting a war in Vietnam. So 46 years, and the bottom 90% of Americans have gone nowhere. Now, at the top, the 1% of the 1%, that's the group that Mitt Romney is at the bottom of, and Bill Gates and Larry Ellison and hedge fund managers that you hear about like John Simon are at the top of. Those folks' average income went up by $18 million per household as measured by the tax system. Their real incomes went up by probably five times that much, but their incomes measured by the tax system went up $18 million. So 90% of Americans went absolutely nowhere after 46 years, and these other folks went from about $5 million a year to about $23 million a year. And the folks at the top are paying a much smaller share of their income in taxes. They've had their taxes cut 60%, and the rest of us, our taxes are a little bit higher than they were in 1966 because we're paying much more in Social Security and Medicare taxes.
There was somebody who came on one of our discussions. Her name is Lois Wiener. She's a professor of education in New Jersey and very active in the teachers' union. And she talked about the neoliberal plan for education that perhaps in the future only about 20% of the population would be able to go to college because there's no reason to educate the rest of the population because they're all going to be working at Walmart or some low-paying job. They don't need more than a ninth grade education.
Well, if they're working at all, I mean, we're seeing that a shrinking share of the population is working. Since the year 2000, the population has been growing at roughly 10 times the rate of jobs. And there's a clear movement in this country by the far right to say, why do we need to spend all this money educating people who really can't use it? And they're not talking about college. They're talking about high school level education. So our economic competitors are all busy saying we want a growing share of our population to have college degrees and postgraduate degrees, and not just in what's called STEM, science, technology, engineering, but in the arts, in history, in a whole wide variety of fields. But in America, we're developing this attitude of, oh, that's so expensive. And what I think we're really doing is creating a new minority, children. Children are slowly becoming the new minority in America.
So the powers that be, understanding the way, I mean, they have the information about the way the other world, the other parts of the world are moving towards greater education for all and a more complex liberal arts education for all. The powers that be in America must not think that this is going to be important to their future well-being.
Well, if you're a global level capitalist, you don't care where the people live. Why would you hire American software writers and pay them $120,000 a year, including benefits and costs, when you could go to India and hire someone of equal talent for maybe $30,000 all in? Of course, you're going to, if you have no loyalty to the country, do exactly that. Some years ago, the Reuters News Service, before I spent a year working for them as their worldwide economics columnist, announced that they were firing, I think it was 20 journalists in the U.S. and North America, and replacing with people in India, and they would hire 60 people, so three times as many jobs, but they were going to save a lot of money. And I wrote a little piece for journalists pointing out that if this was really about saving money, they could fire the top five executives at Reuters, showed how much they made. They could hire 15 executives, three times as many in India at Indian wages, and they would have saved three times as much money. But of course, that's not what this is about. And so if you're a global level capitalist, if you're Phil Knight, who makes Nike shoes, you're making them in Vietnam, and they're costing you maybe $2 per pair of shoes when they're put on the boat in Ho Chi Minh Harbor. And when they're sold in Brooklyn, they sell for $200. And you take, by the way, all your profits in the Cayman Islands, so you don't pay taxes on them. And why would you hire American workers who, to make the shoes, might cost $6 or $8 when you can go to Vietnam? So there's no reason for global level capitalists in America to care about this country at all, because they don't need to. There's no economic reason for them to do so under our current trade and tax rules.
If you know, I mean, I know you've written that it's perfectly legal and that it is perfectly legal. But I mean, if I was making a movie out of this, this would be a crime drama. You know, it's
a gangster. It's gangsterism. There's meaning to it. I mean, there are lots of things that you can do that are legal. That doesn't make them moral or right or proper. And in America, we're seeing the very, very wealthy get these rules passed so that it used to be wealthy people like Nelson Rockefeller's family in the 50s. They had a small airplane. Now you're seeing that plutocrats have their own personal jumbo jets. Sheldon Adelson, the guy who kept Newt Gingrich's campaign alive, owns two, not one, but two 747s, one of which is equipped for skateboarding in the sky by his youngest heirs. The founders of Google have a personal 767. That's a jumbo jet. There's at least one private owner of an Airbus 380, which is much bigger than a 747. And all of these are subsidized by government rules that people know very little about.
So this is like Versailles or something.
Oh, absolutely. And you know, in Versailles, when the Le Petit Trianon was built for Madame Pompadour and then the king's mistress, she was moved out, and Marie Antoinette, the young Austrian queen, took it over and to queen-to-be. And the La Petite Trianon was supposed to have a dining room that had a table which would rise up from the kitchen so that the people partying, the wealthy French aristocrats, didn't have to even look or smell the servants. And it would have been built. We have all the drawings for it, except that something intervened and Marie Antoinette lost her head.
I wonder, this is a little segue away, but I think this story is I find it very interesting. If you could talk about the deregulation of the lack of regulation, lack of policing of the railroad industry in relationship to accidents and the cost cutting, you know, the savings by the railroad.
The railroads in America today are more highly concentrated in their ownership than when we created the Interstate Commerce Commission in the 1880s. And John Snow, who ran the CSX Railroad and then was appointed Treasury Secretary by George H.W. Bush, when he ran that railroad, he was always seeking favors and help from the government. He's a monopolist, and that's essentially what we really have are two duopoly railroads, two in the West, two in the East, that charge excessive prices and abuse their customers willy-nilly. Well, he didn't want to spend money on safety, and he cut and cut and cut safety spending. One day, a train going from Miami to New York reached the a crossing in South Carolina, a crossing that in order as part of the cost-cutting savings had been repaired, not with a big, huge, fat bolt that's supposed to be used, but with a nail. And this nail rusted through, the tracks came apart, 8 cars, Amtrak cars, came flying off the rails. I think it was 8 people were killed, including a Miami police sergeant who was very well known throughout Miami for all of his work to help children. Well, everybody else settled their lawsuits except the widow of this police officer who couldn't believe this was an accident. She kept thinking, accident implies some act of God or something. And so she sued. They proved this matter and got the witnesses to testify over the objections of the railroad that a nail had been used to replace this. And workers testified under oath that they were under tremendous pressure to shortcut and not make repairs to meet the demands of Jon Snow. She won $50 million. And the widow, by the way, gave all this money away to charity. She wasn't in this for the money. This was not blood money.
Uh-huh.
What the jury didn't know was that once the case was settled by the U.S. Supreme Court, the taxpayers paid the bill, not CSX. Even though CSX owned the rails, even though it was CSX's job to maintain the rails, Congress passed a law that if anyone is injured or dies on Amtrak, the taxpayers bear the cost and CSX pays nothing. Well, this goes on all throughout the country. And the railroads even have a rule where you would think if there's two railroads, they compete on price. So imagine you own Lenore's coal-fired power plant. I'm sure that shocks you, but just go with me for a moment.
Hey.
And you're getting your coal from a mine 1,000 miles away, and two railroads run side by side from the mouth of that mine to the town you're in. But for the last mile, only one railroad goes to your electric power plant. Well, you would think you could go negotiate a competitive price for 1,000 miles, and then the last 1 mile, you'd pay a huge jacked-up price. Nope. The federal government regulatory agency called the Surface Transportation Board has a rule that says they get to charge a monopoly price for the entire length, even though there appears to be competition. And furthermore, the contract itself is secret, even if, Lenore, you're the chairman of a public board, like the Brooklyn Power Company, if there were such a thing. It's secret. And in one town I wrote about in my book, The Fine Print, Lafayette, Louisiana, the monopoly charges of the railroad are so much that if they had a competitive price, and we don't know the details of it, but we know the cost they're paying. If they had a competitive price for shipping coal, they could cut everybody's property taxes 10%. Think about that. Everybody in town is paying 10% more than they need to in property taxes just to feed the railroad's money machine. No wonder our economy is in trouble.
So in your book, touch on over and over again how big business rigs the marketplace so it doesn't have to compete actually. And how it gets all of these subsidies out of our joint funds, the taxpayer funds. And I wonder if you could just, in as we get close to the end here, if you could speak to the thing about the Yankees and the Mets, or because we're in New York.
The New York Times, when I was working there, kept reporting that there was no subsidy for the Yankee Stadium. And I finally found a way to horn myself into that story, and I got Randy Levine on the phone. Randy Levine was the deputy mayor under the former prosecutor who was mayor, whose name
Giuliani.
Giuliani. He was Giuliani's deputy mayor in charge of giving money away. And then he went to work for the Steinbrenners. And he said to me, there's no subsidy in Yankee Stadium. And then I cited him a report by the Independent Budget Office. And he went, well, some. In fact, 78% of the cost of baseball and football and stadiums in this country are paid for by the taxpayers. And the Steinbrenners took away a park from poor children. And the story of that park, which I tell in the book Free Lunch, and the dedicated man who was an immigrant late 1800s, who got us the whole park system in the Bronx, and who was bitterly attacked as being corrupt and out for himself. He died in a unheated tenement with the equivalent of 15 cents in his pocket when he was 70 years old. This is a man who was dedicated and selfless, who was attacked. The Steinbrenners just ripped the taxpayers off. And one of the stories I tell is about how the Steinbrenners got a contract to build two ships for the Navy. Another company got a contract to build two ships. Well, the other contractor built both ships on time, under budget. The Steinbrenners got $400 million, never finished the ships. You can go down to the St. Charles River in Florida and look at them, rusting at anchor. But they stole all this money legally.
Is there a way at this point, are there big businesses that aren't taking taxpayer money, that aren't creating their wealth off a chunk of taxpayer money? You know,
it would be pretty hard to compete under the rules we have today. One of the problems we have is that we have rules that drive out good practices. Back when we had MCI, you remember the long distance company that the head of Bernie
yes.
Evers is serving basically life in prison for? AT&T's Michael Armstrong, the CEO of that company, had his staff do a study. How can they be charging these prices and reporting these phenomenal profits? And we found out years later that his staff wrote a report to him in which they said, it's not possible. They can't be making money. This must be a huge accounting fraud. Well, in fact, we now know it was a huge accounting fraud. But it forced AT&T to do things it didn't want to do. And all throughout our economy, bad practices are destroying legitimate, reasonable business practices to the detriment of consumers. And that's what my latest book, The Fine Print, which just came out in paperback, tells about. It tells about, we have an industry in America that got itself exempted from the corporate income tax. Then it got a regulation passed that requires you to pay them as an add-on, not just the corporate income tax of 35%, but what's called the grossed up corporate income tax. That's 54%. And they keep the money. You pay them this money to pay the government, and they legally, because they don't pay corporate income taxes, get to keep it. And federal judges blessed this. And this is going on all throughout our economy, and the news media is paying no attention to this. When I was pursuing these things at the end of my 13 years at the New York Times, this is not what editors wanted to hear. They didn't want to hear about how the consumers are having their pockets clean. You know, they wanted stuff they thought was sexier, even though every time I would write a piece like this, it would go to the, 10 most emailed stories list.
So the obviously the press is in on the on my perception of the cabal.
Well, I wouldn't say it's in on it. I mean, to be fair, I've had other journalists criticize me about this. Most journalists do not have any background in public administration, statistics, economics. They went into journalism to tell stories. And so they accurately quote what people tell them. And I've had people say it's not fair of me because when I was young and I knew I was going to be a journalist, I studied these things to hold other journalists to that standard. But, there are a lot of these things that are going on right in public. I mean, the ripoffs that are going on by Keychain against Con Ed customers, by the Long Island Power System against customers, the excessive charges Wall Street is putting on for bond servicing. It's a tiny amount of money on one measure. It'll be 50 cents per $100. But if you're loaning $100 billion across a bunch of deals, now you're talking really big money. In half the states, a multi-billion dollar tax deferral accounts that were utility companies had were stolen legally by the companies. And nobody will do anything to stop this. Pension funds are being looted left and right. But to do that, you've got to know it. Now, the one area where the Times, by the way, has done very well is Mary Williams Walsh at the New York Times covers pensions, and she's done a bang-up job of reporting on all of the numerous ways that Wall Street is looting pensions. It hasn't stopped any of the looting. It hasn't fixed the problem, but at least that is one area where the Times has been tough in writing about it.
So when we talk about, for instance, I'd like to talk about now how to overcome some of these problems. And one of the things, going back to journalism for a second, are we talking about better education in journalism schools? I mean, I don't understand. I mean, I just walked down. It's like, what it feels like. I remember there was a street near my house, and I'd walk down the street and I could see the people selling the dope. And somebody in the neighborhood said to me, oh, well, the cops don't, nobody knows about it. What do you mean they don't know about it? Everybody knows about it. It's right there in front of you.
They don't want to know about it, and they especially don't want to know about it if some of them were getting paid off. And we know in this case, though, Lenore, there's a couple of bigger problems. I mean, one of them is huge numbers of people have stopped paying attention to the news, and the budgets of news organizations have fallen away. In Philadelphia, more than 80% of the jobs covering government have gone away. The scandal in Bell, California, that little poor blue-collar town where the city manager was making $800,000, the police chief over $500,000, that was all done in public because no journalist was ever sent for years to cover the Bell Council meetings. So part of this is the public's not paying attention to the news, therefore there isn't the money to go do it. But the really important part of this is that we have had a moral breakdown at the top in this country. Bob Crandall, who was the CEO of American Airlines, when they dreamed up the loyalty programs, you know, the Advantage, the miles for flying deals, he, in the documentary The Heist, which I'm also in, talks about how businesses are doing things that are awful. When I was a young man, I remember news stories about companies that had to lay people off, and the head of the company, back then we called them presidents, would announce, I'm only going to work for a dollar a year. I'm going to reject all my bonuses until everybody's hired back. Now, they dance up and down, going, I fired a bunch of people. The stock should go up. All the result of Jack Welch, and remember when he was called Neutron Jack back 30 years ago, firing people left and right and seeing the stock price go up. The accounting firms and the law firms that enable these deals through tax shelters and a whole variety of mechanisms, they're focused solely on making money, and that's because of a change in the law that changed us from having what were called partnerships to limited liability partnerships. The first kind encourages virtuous behavior under the law and perfectly legal. I explain this, my book, Perfectly Legal. And the other kind, limited liability partnership, punishes you if you try to nose around about what appears to be bad behavior by your partners and exposes you to liability. So this moral breakdown at the top and the institutionalizing of it in multiple ways that I've been writing about for years are at the core of this. And until people decide they're going to take their government back, they're going to throw out the people who are acting on behalf of the biggest companies and against their interests, until we get unions back so that we have market economics in the labor market, not plutocrat economics, this is going to get worse and worse and worse. And my answer to that is stop watching Dancing with the Stars, pick an issue, organize, get involved, take back your government.
I see. Okay, because that's what I want to talk about a little bit towards the end here, the ways in which we can overcome. Because I think you've quoted, and I've certainly thought about this. I mean, human beings have overcome all kinds of things. We've overcome feudalism and slavery.
It took 638,000 dead Americans, but we got rid of it. We got women back the right to vote. We got child labor laws when there were ministers running around saying it is God's plan that these children work in these factories. We had in the 30s good union laws, and we had regulation of banks that for 50 years we didn't have any significant bank failures in this country. We've lost all of that. We took all these virtuous things we had, and we've thrown them away so that a narrow group of people can make a lot of money. Those things were won through years of hard work. This idea that you can just say, oh, well, that's bad, that doesn't change anything. You've got to elect different people to office. You've got to get people to show up to vote. You know, one of the reasons Governor Snyder was not recalled in Wisconsin is that the right put money into driving people to the polls. Uh-huh. And the left just assumed he was so awful that they would win the election.
I see. So we campaign financing?
The campaign financing explains something that should really bother Americans. If you add up all the votes for Congress in the year 2012, the Democrats got 1.4 million more votes than the Republicans, but the Republicans are in control of the House. Why? Because at the state legislatures in a bunch of states, they created these super Democratic districts where, you know, 90% of the voters are Democratic, which means they can't vote in any other districts. And that kind of thing we need to change, but you have to be paying attention. You have to do the work. And I'm sure some people are saying, well, somebody else can do it. Well, then fine, you're going to suffer the consequences. If you want to live in a democracy, the people have the vote, but it doesn't do them any good if they're not active.
In the in the uh, in in th- those in th- these social movements that have been forced to the fore. The civil rights movement, I was part of that and briefly, mm-hmm. and these gained steam and kept going because the situation it was a combination of things that came together that kept this happening. And then the
And people were smart about it and they stuck to it. I mean, soldiers came home from World War II and they were not going to put up anymore with the racism that we had, the institutionalized racism. But that was 1945. We didn't get the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act until almost two decades later. And it took smart leaders. It took determination to get that change. It took Gandhi, 47 years? Finally, the British walked out, which he said they would do. But it took almost a half century. And things will not change overnight. But if you just sit there and say, oh, I'd rather watch Dancing with the Stars. I'd rather watch, whatever on the tube. I want to play my video game, Grand Theft Auto. It's not going to get better.
Yes, it's not. But I think we're in the midst of that. I think that although I am, I teach at a small college, and I am surprised at how many of my students don't have any problem with NSA, with people looking at their information.
Yes, I agree with you. My students, I teach third year law students at Syracuse. I'm not a lawyer, but I've taught there for 5 years. And graduate business students, they don't read the news, they don't go to movies, but they play video games. And they're not troubled about the spying on them by the government. That's incredibly disturbing that some of them are, but most of them are not. And they think of politics as something other people do. That's one of the legacies of the campaign finance system. You can't get access to your congressperson, but the big donors can. And if we were to stop that system, if we were to take away the Supreme Court's view that dollars are free speech, I think we'd see a quick major change in our country.
So we've got 20 seconds left. Time flies. And is there anything you'd like to...
Please read my books, Perfectly Legal, Free Lunch, The Fine Print. I'm not going to make another dollar on them, but please read them and tell other people what you learned.
They're good books, and they're easy reads, and they're well worth it. This is Lenore Von Stein. This is David K. Johnston. Bye.